is very, I mean, you are very lucky that, I mean, you know. And if you are lucky today, because I mean, he can clear all of his, I mean, busy schedule to be with you today, I mean, for the whole, I mean, afternoon session. So, Ajahn Yongyuth, what we call Ajahn in Thai, so Ajahn is teacher. I mean, Ajahn Yongyuth, I mean, he was awarded numerous awards, I mean, including Outstanding Scientist of Thailand, and he also got award from Japan, Nikkei, Asia Prize for Science, Technology, and Innovation. So actually, he's kind of, I would say, because I've been working with him for, I mean, more than 10 years, almost 20 years, that 20, almost 20 years working with him, I would say he's a hardcore scientist. And somehow, as you see on the screen, he's now the Deputy Prime Minister, I mean, of Thailand. And how come a scientist, hardcore scientist, great scientist, can become Deputy Prime Minister? So I think today he's going to talk to you, I mean, quite interesting, I mean, stuff, not about, not much on science. It's science at everything. So it's quite interesting topics to me also. So, I mean, hopefully, I mean, you enjoy the session. So please join me to welcome Professor Yongyuth Yuthavong.
Good afternoon. Have you had a good lunch? Very good. Whatever you do during my talk, please don't fall asleep. After a good lunch, it's so easy to fall asleep. But if you do fall asleep, please don't snore. Or if you snore, please don't snore too loudly. Well, I'm very pleased to be talking to you today. I would regard you as my potential colleagues. You will, hopefully, a lot of you will grow up to be scientists, right? Well, yes, I haven't heard. Okay, that's very good. Because when I was your age, I wasn't sure. You know, I thought maybe I'd be a doctor, but I don't really like to cure sick people. Maybe, you know, I thought maybe I'll be an engineer. But at that time, you know, at that time, engineering courses didn't have biology. So I thought, well, what's education if there's no biology? So I really had a hard time. So today, I'm glad to be talking to you and almost retracing my steps. And since you're all from Asia, right? Asian Science Camp, right? 28 countries, right? So I thought this morning when I got up, what shall I wear? So, you know, with shirt and necktie, that's okay. But I better wear something Asian. So here, you can see me. Or maybe I should take off this. Well, my wife bought this for me. And I think she said it's somewhere. Unfortunately, I could not get whether it's from India or Indonesia. But anyway, it's natural fiber, so it's very good. And this is, you know, I want to welcome you. And first of all, I want to roll up my sleeves so that we really get into action. Well, the topic of today's talk is science everything? I got this question. It's been bugging me for a long time. And especially about 10 years ago, there was a guy who wrote, Bill Bryson, wrote a book. Have you heard of this book? Yeah? And some people, have you read it? Well, it's good that you are honest because it's a big, big, thick book. And I'm honest too. I think I've gone through half of it. Well, the rest, I looked at the pictures, beautiful pictures. Now, Bill Bryson wrote a book called A Short History of Nearly Everything. Not quite everything, but nearly everything. And it's all about science. You know, I thought, this is great. And the pictures were so good. And he said this. He said that everything that has happened from the Big Bang to the rise of civilization, you know, everything, how we got from there being nothing at all to here being us. And I was thinking, well, yesterday we already knew we are made of stardust. So this is kind of everything, isn't it? It should be everything. Science should be really about everything. So science is everything, but there is some question in my mind, really. Certainly, nearly everything concerning the world around us or within us, it's really science in essence. Think about the stars, the universe, the world around us, the rocks, the trees, human beings, you know, the stars and everything about cosmology. Well, we talked about introduction of cosmology yesterday, so that's all everything in the universe. And then when we come to the world, then there is the inorganic matters. Well, that's really chemistry, isn't it? That's chemistry plus geology. If you really want to know about the rocks, and if you want to know about the how they react, how they interact, that's chemistry. And of course, physics and mathematics govern all this. And when we come nearer to ourselves, you know, living things, the trees and the ecosystem around us, that's a lot of biology there. So is science everything? Especially, you know, perhaps it's everything concerning, well, I like to have all them kind of letters, the same letters. So imagination. Well, science is all about imagination. And imagination certainly can get you anywhere, everywhere. So everything you can really imagine. Science is about investigation. And of course, when you investigate, you can investigate everything or anything. The last one is a little bit of a, you know, trying to, in fact, I should say discovery, but it's a D, it's not an I. So the nearest is invention, because invention is really very, you know, related to discovery. In fact, industrial people like to think that invention is even more important than discovery. Well, in the United States, you know, you can really patent discoveries nowadays, because they say in the States that discovery and inventions are about the same. This is kind of mental process and the manipulations that will get you some new things. So surely science is everything. Let's talk about imagination. Well, one way of looking at this is creation of unusual concepts. You have to imagine something that other people have not imagined before. Unusual scenarios. What if situations? For example, what if we can be invisible? People cannot see us. What if? So, what if we can make life out of non-life? Something like this. So what if is the beginning of imagination. But then in science, you cannot just imagine alone. If you imagine, I can see some of you are sleeping already, but thank you very much for not snoring. No, you see, sometimes you know, the what if situation, in fact, it's a little bit easy because we can think of what if, what if, what if. But the hard part in science is how. How do you then go about to prove or disprove your imagination or to make your imagination become real? That is the hard part. So imagination requires opening of the mind to conceive of various possibilities, and then we take the most reasonable, you know, reasonable possibilities in light of existing rules and evidence and so on. We cannot just have a free bar and then imagine anything. But imagination in science has to be kind of ruled by all the laws that we know, that they should not break all the laws that we know, you know, natural laws. So imagination does have to have some discipline. So then I thought of a song by John Lennon. Have you heard of John Lennon? Do you know this song? Ah, can you sing it? Can you sing it, please? Can someone sing it? Oh, you're pointing to the other. You should point to yourself. Why don't we sing it together? Okay. Okay, someone should start. Imagine no possessions, I wonder if you can. No need for greed or hunger, a brotherhood of man, of women also. Imagine all the people sharing all the world, you who. You're all good. You're so good. In fact, we can sing the whole song, but then it will take the lecture away. So then I think you all know Einstein and his saying about imagination and knowledge, which I think I'd like to just put it here again, because this is important. Imagination is more important than knowledge, for knowledge is limited. And by the way, it's changing all the time. While imagination embraces the entire world, I think we should really remember Einstein, you know, as especially what he said about imagination. So let's imagine an old concept. Let's imagine evolution. So before Darwin, there was a guy, or he was a priest called Lamarck. Have you heard of Lamarck? Yeah, okay. Lamarck said that individuals of a species will undergo changes due to living conditions, and the changes are inherited. Well, we know all the examples of the giraffe. See, the giraffe. You know, this one doesn't reach the leaves, the tree are high up there. This one reaches and it can eat and grow. This one tries very hard. And Lamarck says that you try hard enough, you know, one day your neck will be longer and longer. And if you don't die first, then you can get some leaves and then you can survive. So that's the first, well, one of the first theories of evolution. Now Darwin came along and said, no. Oh, by the way, Lamarck, in today's terms, we say it's really going from phenotype to genotype. That means the outer expression, you know, then goes to the genes, and then the genes are changed in today's understanding. Now, then Darwin came along and said, no, it's not like that. It's individual of a species will undergo a random variation due to random genetic changes. You know, you never know what changes occur because they are random. And some of the changes are good, most of the changes are bad and the individuals will die. But some of the changes are good. Some of the changes, you know, somehow influence the neck of the giraffe so that it grows longer and the giraffe survives and thrives. And then that gene gets passed along to offsprings. So this is really genotype to phenotype. So two very different theories from imagination. Of course, the correctness of Darwin was tested by many experiments. I will just give you some example of the classical experiment by Joshua Lederberg, the former the Nobel Prize winner who came to Thailand, to this place many times, actually. I will also show you that Lamarck could also have some support, some new support. So don't throw away, you know, all theories too quickly. You know, even Lamarck, which I thought when I was a child, well, that's wrong. But nowadays, there's certain things called epigenetics. That means some influence from outside, you know, some conditions from outside can come and change your genes, and they can make the genes change, and then you can have permanent changes. So let's talk about Darwin's first. Darwin's replica plating is really a classic experiment which shows you that the theory of evolution actually can be explained by random genetic changes. Lederberg asked a very simple question. How does resistance to a drug occurs, you know, in bacteria? Do bacteria kind of acquire resistance from getting exposed more and more to the drug, and then they acquire resistance and they can survive? Or is it this way, that bacteria already have heterogeneity, you know, differences in all the bacteria? Some of them happen to have genes that will survive the drug. Those that do not have such genes, such resistant genes, will die in the presence of the drug. So two opposing theories. And this was explained very nicely by the replica plating, where you, first of all, you grow bacteria in a plate like this. You have many colonies. And then you do the kind of the replica plating. You put it on a velvet so that the bacteria transferred there, and then you plate it on plate. Now the plate with drug streptomycin, which will kill most of the bacteria, but some will survive. You know, in Lederberg's experiment, some did survive, and only one of all these various colonies survived. And you can take that and then take that surviving colony, and then you can show that the first group of bacteria, when you grow, it will all be killed, or almost all be killed by the drug, whereas the ones that have survived will grow and flourish. So this is very clear that evolution, in this case, evolution towards drug resistance occurs through original changes that already are in the bacteria. They're already among the various bacteria that's available. And that's how selection occurs. This is called natural selection. And it's not due to the fact that the bacteria have grown used to the drug. So I think that is very clear. And there are many other experiments that will prove that evolution actually, by the Darwin's explanation, is actually the correct explanation. Now, just before we leave this, I have a couple of points here. Imaginations, of course, are important. But many, many centuries ago, there's a guy, another priest, called Ockham, William of Ockham, who said that you should really use only necessary imaginations. Don't imagine too many things. Don't put too many things on the table. Science needs minimum explanation. So what he calls this principle Occam's razor. We call them Occam's razor. That is, you have to use this razor, Occam's razor, to really cut off all the unnecessary explanation. So you can explain any phenomenon. The best explanation is when you have as few assumptions as possible. We eliminate those that make no difference or may even make problems for your explanation. So this is principle of Occam's razor. So I would like to put this to you because sometimes we may use too much imagination and we may end up with too many explanations. But I admit, sometimes it is difficult to know. Now, when you're working in science, sometimes it's difficult to know whether you're really making too many hypotheses, you're having too many imaginations, many explanations or not. Sometimes it's difficult to know. Let's look at some examples in history. You know, before Einstein, people thought that space was really filled with something called ether. I'm not sure how they spelled it. Well, filled with ether, so that wherever you go, it's there. You know, yesterday I thought of the what's called the dark matter. maybe it's a new ether because it's everywhere, dark matter. But anyway, ether that people before Einstein were talking about is something different, and the concept of ether was actually turned out to be unnecessary, in fact even wrong, because of the fact that, you know, the speed of the light is the same, you know, wherever you however fast you're moving. So the speed of light is always the same, and it's impossible to have such, you know, phenomenon when there is ether in all of the space, because ether would then fix all the coordinates and then the speed of light will never be the same, whereas we know that speed of light is the same no matter whether any object is moving fast or not. So that's unnecessary or even wrong imagination. Another wrong imagination is the concept of vital force. You know, before we knew a lot of about biology, people used to think that whatever is living, you know, apart from the components that are there, the matters that are there in the living beings, people thought that there must be some vital force, you know, some force that make, you know, a living being, you know, alive. So the concept of vital force was shown to be unnecessary and even wrong, because now we know that that life, you know, can originate when the components are there, when there are necessary components, and the concept called vital force is not needed. But certain things, you know, I must admit that sometimes it's very difficult to know whether you have unnecessary imagination or not. For example, I used to think, many people think that, hey, we talk about DNA as genetic, you know, element, RNA can be genetic element. What about proteins? And then, you know, people said, oh, not necessary because we already have DNA and RNA and the codons and all that. So you can already can explain the phenomenon of life and genetics without using proteins, you know, as genetic element. But then if you really think hard, all this is about information. If information from DNA is transferred to RNA, from RNA to proteins, then the information is inherently there. And why not? You know, why can't proteins be genetic elements? So I think this was kind of considered as wrong or unnecessary imagination and so on. Until just about 30 years ago, then there was concept that Dr. Prusiner showed that there are proteins such as prions, which actually carry kind of the information in itself that can turn other proteins into prions. So This is information that can be carried over. So if you think of genes as information, then certainly proteins have a chance to be genetic elements. So anyway, I think I'm not enough of a specialist to really know about this, but I think this is a case where sometimes it's difficult to know whether that whether you should use the Occam's razor to cut off the possibility of proteins as genetic elements. Come back to imagination. I looked at talking to you. I admit I thought that you were 10 or 12 years old. JS didn't tell me that you're grown up almost. So I looked up Walt Disney and I saw this song, but I don't know this song. Does any of you know this song? You can fly. Someone not, no? Anyway, I don't know it. If someone knows it, she or he can sing, but anyway, it's a cartoon, You Can Fly, I think Peter Pan. When there's a smile in your heart, there's no better time to start. Think of all the joy you'll find when you leave the world behind. Bid your cares goodbye. You can fly, you can fly, you can fly, you can fly. And in fact, it's true. Look, we can fly. You've all flown here, right? You've all flown here. Yes. So fairy tales do come true. We can fly. Why not? We can see and talk to one another virtually. Oh, I should turn off my iPhone. See? We can see and talk to one another virtually. We can see the universe. We saw it yesterday. We can see molecules and atoms, and perhaps one day even smaller things. So that's all about imagination. Now let's turn to investigation. And in this, I used some cartoons from my friend who called himself G. Penn. G. Penn studied science just like you. But then in his career, he thought, well, he's very good in drawing. So he thought he perhaps would better become an illustrator. So he's an illustrator and he writes cartoons and sometimes he writes science cartoons. I asked him to write cartoons, when I was writing a book called The Spirit of Science. And I told him to write about curiosity, and this is what he thinks is curiosity. You see, he likes women, certainly. So his curiosity is a beautiful lady. Well, that's good, that's okay. But the spirit of investigation, you can't only have just curiosity alone. That would be idle. If you have just curiosity and you do nothing, you will get nowhere. You must have work, and you must have discipline in your work. So you see, this guy doesn't just sit there and dream about beautiful things, but he sits and works. He works. And you must have also what I call rebellious spirit. You mustn't be too obedient. And in fact, your parents know this. You know, if you say, yes, yes, mom, yes, dad, all the time, then, well, your mother and father may love you, but you may not get very far in science. You have to be able to say, no, why not this? You know, what about this possibility? You can't do that? Or you do that all the time, I'm sure. So you really have to think about other possibilities. You really have to be a rebel a little bit. But not too much as though, you know, and then you go and destroy everything. You have to be a disciplined rebel. So work discipline. You know, you have to work hard. You have rebellious spirit. And I asked G. Penn, write, draw something about rebellious spirit. And this is what he drew. Ooh. So I said, Rebellion is to think of something else in order to gain new knowledge, new principles. So this is what he thinks, you know, you think out of the box, so to say. You know, so this guy is now a rebel. And then you see, because he steps out of the box, now he finds a hula hoop. So now he has more fun. So now he can change, you know. So I think I would like to ask you, please, to be rebels, but not rebels in the kind of the way that makes everything worse, you know, but rebels in your imagination, rebels in your doing, and then you can think of something that is different from others, and then you can go on and work out something that is different and new, and maybe it's even better than before. So, lastly, inventions. This is what he wrote, you know, he drew inventions. Unfortunately, you know, he thinks that this is where Thailand is. Well, we did invent this, you know. We did invent the paddle boat. Well, other countries also. Other countries seem to go, you know. Oh, I think many of you are here, right? Korea, Japan. What's this? I can't see. Vietnam, Singapore, Malaysia, so on, Cambodia. And here's Thailand. Bye-bye. And the other people. But anyway, this is the point of this drawing is science does lead to inventions. So imagination. What's the second one? Investigation. You see, I'm getting to even forget my own my own lines. Investigation and invention. So, seem to be everything. Now, before we leave the issue of invention, maybe I should just tell you a little bit about our own work and some people from my group. In fact, it's not my work. You know, I only have the imagination, mostly. And the people who are sitting in front here in Chairat and so on are people who help me in the work of making new antimalarials. And I better go back into history to say that in Thailand, we revere Rama IV as the father of Thai science. And more than 100 years ago, he went to the south. He calculated that there would be an eclipse on the 18th of August, you know, in 1868. He calculated, and then because he was a kind of a king scientist and mathematician, he calculated, and then he went with a contingent to the south of Thailand at Wak Gaw at Prachuap, you know, to observe the eclipse. And the eclipse actually occurred, and there were a lot of other people, you know, from other areas as well. I think Singapore and various countries. Unfortunately, he stayed on, you know, after the eclipse occurred, he stayed on a few more days. He got bitten by the malarious mosquitoes, and he died a few weeks later from malaria. So it's both a joyous occasion and a sad occasion for Thailand. So National Science Day for Thailand is 18th of August. So now, today, we have various scenarios in the combats against malaria. Malaria is still a very important disease in the world. It kills about 600,000 people every year, mostly in Africa. There's a lot of drug resistance. So I talked to you about drug resistance. There's a lot of drug resistance in malaria, so that each antimalarial drug will be useful for a while, only a few years, and then resistance will occur, and you need to find new drugs. So there are many scenarios. You know, happy scenario. What if we can have a world completely free of malaria? That would be very happy. Well, maybe if not, we have continuously shrinking pockets of malaria or stable pockets of malaria here and there and so on. So that's okay. So that's an okay situation not the most desirable, but that's okay. But the saddest situation is if the situation is still very much the same, and we should not have that. So here in Thailand at Biotech here in NASDA, we had a lot of investigation over many years together with scientists from Mahidol University, Chulalongkorn University, and also abroad, you know, from Monash University, London University, and so on. So it's a big, you know, a team that's working on a target of anti-malarial called DHFR, which is short for dihydrofolate reductase. Don't worry about the name. But DHFR is the molecular target. It's a protein, it's an enzyme in a malaria parasite that it uses, you know, for kind of making many things, including the DNA and various other metabolites, you know, anything that includes putting one carbon on a molecule, then the DHFR would be very important. So there are also enzymes like this in human cells as well as in bacteria and so on. So the trick is to find drugs that will target this enzyme. And in the past, there have been drugs, old drugs like pyrimethamine and cycloguanil have been shown already to target this malarial enzyme. Unfortunately, the malaria, especially in Thailand, is so strong. They've all become resistant to these drugs. So our task is whether to rescue this target and find some new drugs that will attack the target. And we know the mechanism for resistance is some mutations in the active site of this enzyme. So the mutations occur so that the old drugs can no longer bind effectively. So we have to find new drugs, design new drugs, so that these new drugs will still be able to bind the mutated enzyme and still kill the parasite. So that's really the kind of the problem that we need to do. So you can kind of think about this in a kind of figurative way, like we are the troops of Rama, you know, we're all monkeys, you see. So we're the troops of Rama, and Rama has to shoot arrows straight, but unfortunately, this is not Ravan. Do you all know Ramayana? Yeah. Ah, yes. So you know what I'm talking about. Ravan is, in fact, the HFR, which is changing all the time. You know, it's changing. It can really disguise itself. In fact, its heart is somewhere. You know, it takes its heart and go put it somewhere. So it's changing. The enzyme is changing all the time. So how can Rama shoot straight and kill the enemy? So after many long stories, we did design and made many drugs, and one of which is called P218. It still doesn't have a commercial name yet, but it's now in the late clinical trial. And P218 is somewhat similar to the old drugs, you know, in that it has a nucleus, which this is important for binding, you know, at the active site. This part is very important in binding at the active site. Now, the old drugs will have something that protrudes out, and then the rest of the drug cannot bind. You know, the mutant enzyme have something in the active site. So we design something which is flexible. This is a flexible side chain so that this can really veer, you know, kind of have a configuration that will avoid clash with the mutated active site. And so we found this with excellent enzyme potency, that is, bind the enzyme very well and kills the malarial cells very well, no cytotoxicity or mutagenicity. Everything's going well. So here's how the binding, you know, occurs. Human has enzyme, the HFR also, so our task is to find something which does not bind human enzyme very well, but something that will bind with the malarial enzyme, especially the mutated enzyme, very well. So you see the structure of human enzyme is in brown or yellow, and the plasmodium, that's a malarial parasite, you know, it's in blue, and this is the drug P218. So what happens with this drug P218? It has no toxicity because look how it binds to the human enzyme. It binds quite differently from the binding with the parasite enzyme. Binding with parasite enzyme, this side chain can point out and then make hydrogen bonding. You see all these dashes are hydrogen bonding with arginines and various things here. Whereas the human enzyme, there is, you know, some difference here in that there is a phenylalanine here which has its side chain just blocking the side chain of the drug. Oh, I shouldn't do this. Side chain of the drug cannot come here anymore. In the human case, it has to veer sideways and then make very poor interaction with the water molecule here. So binding to the human enzyme is very, very weak, whereas binding to the parasite enzyme is strong, and that explains why the drug is so effective in killing the malaria parasite and is not toxic to humans. So that's, to put a long story short, but you may be wondering, what's all this about? You know, this is an afternoon, you know, after all, I've had a very heavy lunch, and why are you doing this to me? So I just want to make it easy for you. It's all a matter of postures. You can see it's all a matter of postures, how molecules bind and interact with one another. Now, postures is also very important in Ramayana, especially the cone dance, the classical dance. As you can see, you see that's why Rama can kill Ravan, because his posture is, he's doing this, whereas the demon is, So this is very important. You must have some molecules which will be able to bind with the active site, you know, effectively. And then your molecule will be like Rama, you see, the posture like Rama. But if not, then maybe you will become Ravan. You know, you will be killed by the parasite. So that's how I try to. Does it work, by the way? Doesn't work? Okay, you make me happy. All right, good. So now to round up things, I think that we have the span of science, a very large span, from subatomic structures to the universe. You know, subatomic structures, atoms, molecules, living, non-living things, Earth, solar system, and universe, and not just one universe, universes, you see. So that's all in the span of science. So is science everything? And yet, consider this. Poetry, literature, drama, music, paintings, sculptures, etc. Is science here? Some yes, some no, some maybe. We'll talk about this in the camp, by the way. So we'll have to admit that science is almost, although it's almost everything, it's not quite everything, because all these elements, you know, seem to, maybe science is a part of it, but certainly not all of it. And what about these? Law, politics, banking, or even ordinary living, and earning a living. You know, when you're earning a living, when you're selling something, are you thinking about science? So science is, well, unfortunately, not everything. So I was looking at the, you know, I was invited to play Hamlet a few months ago. So I thought that this was a very good quotation there are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy. So maybe we scientists have to be humble, and we have to say that science is a lot of things, but not everything. So is science everything? Not everything, as I said, but very, very many things important. At least to us here, right? Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. But we should not forget other things. And I think that it's true that these other things will make our lives more complete. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ajahn Yongyuth. So it's question time.
Hello. Thank you very much for your lecture. I know you said a lot about the future scientists, and I would like, this is not like an academic question, but I would like you to tell us your personal opinion on what do you expect from us young scientists from all over Asia. Could you like give us some dreams or goals for us?
Well, I expect you all to go out and learn and find new things, you know, that we haven't managed to find before up to now. So I think now there's a lot of opportunities. In the old days, well, you're from Japan, so, right? So you have been lucky for many generations. But many countries in Asia, you know, we're only just starting to be able to do it. This generation, your generation. Because nowadays, I think IT has made it possible to do a lot of things, and we can travel, we can fly, you see. We can travel about and then go and do things elsewhere. So I expect this generation to go out and really find new things and you know, new knowledge and new useful things so that the world will be a better place. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yes, Pakistan. Oh.
Good afternoon, Prime Minister.
I am deputy.
Not deputy.
Not yet. Okay, not yet.
Okay. Okay. So good afternoon, Deputy Prime Minister. I am Mohammad Shoaib from Pakistan. And my question is a semi-academic question. I wanted to know that I have seen in my life that people are driven by some things like religion, they are driven by recognition. So they do what they do because there is one thing in the life they want. Like Einstein, he was driven by curiosity. So I would really like to know your opinion that what is that one thing that should drive us, the young scientists, to achieve our goals in our life?
Mm-hmm. Well, we have maybe the major thing that drives us, but also we have many other influences. Like in my case, the one thing that drives me really is my really desire to know a lot of things, not just science, by the way. You know, at school, you know, I was fascinated by literature, by various things, language and various things. And then there are certain other influences, like my family, you know, my uncle who said, should do this, and then there's my teacher who said, hey, this boy is good for science, you know, and then because I was an obedient boy, I said, okay, I'll do science, and then, you know, as I just said, you know, then it leads me to either medicine or engineering, both of which I'm not too sure that I'm really cut out for it. So this is now back to my own, you know, my own decision. So in the end, there was a scholarship available. I decided to take the scholarship exam. So I think there is certainly yourself is the most important, you know, influence, but there are other influences around you as well that you have to take into account. Thank you.
Also, sir, you mentioned that how you decided your career. I think everyone passes through that stage. So I really want to know that what advice do you have for youngsters so that they can drive, so they can decide their career?
Well, in the toilet, I just met someone who said that thanks to the junior science project, you know, my career is made or something like that. Otherwise, I would become become a doctor. So I said, there's only one life. I think there's only one life for all of us. So most important thing is, what do you want to do with that one life? Oh, by the way, the Buddhists may say, no, there are many other many other lives, you know. But anyway, right now here, there's only one life. So I think it's very important decision. And actually, this is the time, the most important time in your life. You know, when you can look back afterward and say, I made the right decision. I hope you can do that.
Thank you for your answer. Thank you, sir.
Okay, next.
That person.
Thank you, Professor. I am Soo Hyung Lee from South Korea, and after listening to your lecture, I have a question about the usefulness of science. Can you please tell me the value of theoretical pure science?
The what?
Can you tell me the value of pure theoretical science? For example, when children in Africa are still starving, I see theoretical physicists in the United States debating about black holes. Of course, my dream is a theoretical physicist, so could you please tell me about the value of theoretical science, if you find it?
Theoretical science?
Yes.
Oh, yes. I think it has great value because it's really the foundation, isn't it? It's the foundation of knowledge, so that whatever we do later, we'll have to kind of rely on theoretical knowledge. So this is why I said that you must have rebellious spirit, but it must be within the bounds of science. And I think theoretical science really sets up the boundaries. So you can move within that boundary, but theoretical science sets up the limit, and you will, you know, you have to follow that limit. Now, the question is whether to do theoretical science in a country, for example, like Thailand or Bangladesh. I think that's another question, because sometimes it's very difficult to do theoretical science, you know, in a developing country. In a developed country, perhaps, because you have many friends, many colleagues, then you can really understand one another, because the languages would be very specialized. So I think certainly there's value, but maybe, you know, there will certainly have to be some people who do theoretical science. But whether it should be you or not, I think that's your decision. Oh, that's a lot. yeah, I think that lady, yes.
Hello, Professor. My name is Soo Min Yoo from South Korea. And currently, our Earth is facing fatal problems in many aspects. And for example, a country with problems of obesity and a country suffering from famine are existing simultaneously. And also, Earth is now suffering from radical climate changes, natural disaster. And in addition, like, we are suffering from international conflicts among different religion, political philosophy, and etc. And like, these questions actually doesn't seem quite related to science, actually. But like, actually, one of the research which received the Ig Nobel Prize was about mathematical modeling of the embassy to show rather a random selection of legislators would contribute to the increase of efficiency in politics. And then my question is, after acknowledging that science is not everything, actually, what do you think is the role of science for the next few centuries in order to develop Earth as a whole and solve the fatal problems that we are currently facing right now?
Certainly, I think you're correct that there are a lot of problems in this world that apparently is really outside the spheres of science. Take the question of obesity and hunger, and you said that this is ironical that they exist together, and it is true. But in fact, you know, science can help that. You know, nutritional science can help that, and then can help in the problem of obesity and hunger, because then you can kind of try to have food that is nutritious, that nutritious for you and yet doesn't make you obese. And if you are obese, then there are certainly, then science comes in. For example, obese people will tend to have diabetes, then you have to have knowledge about how to deal with diabetes, how to prevent obesity from causing diabetes, how to reduce obesity, and so on. And you talk about the problem of climate change, and certainly science also has a lot to do with climate change. If we can do things that, for example, alternative sources of energy that will, I think Professor Yuan Si Lee talk about, you have alternate sources of energy which doesn't produce the greenhouse gases and so on, then this is how science helped. In fact, the problem of the environment, in fact, I think is really intricately linked with science and how science can help. So I think that you're correct that science is not everything, and you have to look at these very complex problems from many angles. And that's why the scientists have really to work with other people, you know, with politicians, with sociologists, with, people of all from all walks of life in order to be able to solve these very complicated questions. Thank you.
Yeah, and like according to your experience as being a deputy prime minister of Thailand, how can pure science or theoretical science actually be applied to politics or those kind of things?
Apply to
politics or those kind of things?
Yeah, well, logic. I think that's the most important thing that pure science can teach you. You must have logic. Well, in fact, any science, but certainly pure science. You must have logic. You have to be able to reason. You have to be able to think. You know, many politicians cannot think. It's true. It's true. They cannot think. So I think that really what guides, science. Okay. I think you should do your job.
Okay. Set. Sorry. Wait. One more. Okay. You want to ask? Okay.
Thank you, Professor. My question is, as we know that you are a scientist, a very good scientist, and then you are saying that science is very important, but I want to know that why are you trying to prove us that science is not everything? Thank you.
Thank you, our good friend from Laos, he speaks Thai also. I'm not trying to prove to you that science is everything or not everything. I'm just putting it to you that, at first I thought, hey, maybe science is everything. And then when you look around, and then you come to another conclusion. But we're almost everything, so what more do you want?
Okay, last one. Sorry, maybe you.
Hello, Professor. I'm Pratigya from Nepal. And my question is, can you tell us about how Thailand developed itself in science and technology in a very short period of time? How did the government of Thailand make plans for rapid development of science and technology?
Well, it's nice of you to say that Thailand has developed. Although I would like to go along with you, I think we still have a long way to go. We are, looking from facts, World Competitiveness Index or something like that. We're still, in science and technology, we're still number 48 or something like that in the world. Now, 48 is not bad, considering that we have 200 countries in the world. But 48 is still not good enough. So we have to try harder. And I think all of us here around, countries in Asia also, some countries like Japan, Korea, Singapore, they've already made it to the top, maybe top 10, top 20. But our other countries, we really have to try harder and by really coming and talking to one another like this, I think it will help us because when we go back, then we have a wider view of the world and we can tell our colleagues that, hey, look, they're doing very well over there. We have to try harder, right? Okay.
You have lots of quick, lots more time.
Yes. Why don't we go to the back? There are some people in the back. Yeah, okay. Yes.
Hello, sir. Deputy Prime Minister, actually. There's a reason to mention this, actually. It's really good to know that you are conducting research on malaria, while the rest of the world is focusing on AIDS. My question is that we all know that AIDS is actually a preventable disease, and it can easily be prevented. Yet a lot of money is spent each year to conduct research on AIDS. So why are we focusing on a preventable disease, and we are spending a lot of money to conduct research on that disease, whereas we can utilize the same money to conduct research on other disorders like autoimmune disorders that are neither preventable nor can be cured? Thank you.
Well, I think this is a very important question on how to allocate resources to the various problems. AIDS is preventable if people are reasonable. See, people, you know, in times of passion or whatever, in times of need, are not reasonable. So then they go out and get AIDS, and then what do you do? So I think we have to pay attention to all the diseases that affect mankind, and AIDS is one of them. And fortunately, AIDS is now not a fatal disease, you know, so you can have drugs that will really maintain, you for the rest of the life. But we still have need for drugs that can cure AIDS, you know, completely, and also other diseases as well. So I think it's a matter of priorities. And even for Thailand, right now, AIDS is still a very important disease, and we have to make sure. Now, many very complicated problems about AIDS. For example, the most important things about AIDS is for Thailand, we have a 10-year plan where from 10 years from now, we will have achieved three objectives. One, no new infection. How do you get no new infection? Two, no new deaths from AIDS, okay? And three, most importantly, no titra, I'm at a loss for a word. It's not, you mustn't discriminate, no discrimination. No discrimination about AIDS, yes? No discrimination because, funnily enough, you know, the most important problem in Thailand right now is discrimination. For example, there are many villages that when they know someone has AIDS, they will prevent that boy or that girl from coming to school. The whole family have to move out of the village. This is very inhuman. So we have to, because they think that, you know, it's like the plague of the old. They think that they could get AIDS just by touching. You see, this is out of ignorance. So we really have to try to solve these kinds of problems and not just scientific problems. Thank you.
The last one from the back.
Okay, you.
Hello, Professor. I'm Sumumosan from Myanmar. I'm curious about that. Which lifestyle do you usually prefer most? Scientist or prime minister?
Well, I look forward to the day when I come back to join, you know, my lab as a scientist. So I think that politics is important because, you know, it's very important to a very wide range of people all over the country, and maybe even in the world. So politics is important, but it's important more as a duty, you know, it's a human duty. But for science, it's really a human desire to work on something that you like. So I think science is more important.
Okay, I think it's time. I think maybe okay. We should move to the next session.
Right, we have to break in about 10 minutes, right? For about half an hour. So before we break, I think I have promised JS to also to look after the science camp. And then I thought very hard about how to do science camp. You know, at first I thought I would bring a rock, you know, and put the rock in front of you and say, what do you know about this rock? Is this rock everything? But then when I talked to people, that you will last about 3 minutes. Because then, you know, it will be very difficult to conduct, you know, a kind of logical conversation for very long. So I thought that for science camp, for, I don't know whether it's camp 5 or camp 6, I forgot, that I'm looking after, I got the, you know, the help, assistance of my young colleagues who will look after you, that you will be divided into three groups, right? Three groups, and I think all the three groups, you know, will, each one will discuss different topics related to the topic of whether science is everything. So first group will talk or will discuss about evolution as a universal concept. Second group will talk about fairy tales come true in everyday life. Third group will talk about science in non-science subjects. Now each group, you know, is about 50 people, and you will have only about half an hour to talk about the subject of your group. So it's a very short, you know, but I'm sure you are very efficient. You can gather a lot of thoughts, and then we come back together after half an hour to this room, right? JS, we come back to this room, right? After half an hour to in the kind of a plenary.
So half an hour, they come
back.
We
come back here to the plenary so that each group will then present their work.